is probably the big day on Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Senators Ben Nelson and Susan Collins and Robert Byrd now reportedly saying they'll vote for an amendment to repeal the policy after Pentagon review. That means the amendment will probably pass. It would take 60 votes to strip that amendment out later, so for opponents of the policy, the prospects, at least on the Senate side, seem pretty good. On the House side, Iraq War veteran Congressman Patrick Murphy told us last night that he has the votes to pass the same amendment. No one actually knows for sure if he does have those votes, but he says he's got them. The vote in the House could be tomorrow as well. The Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy has been in place for 17 years. More than 14,000 Americans serving in the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines have had their careers ended because of the policy. The president says he wants it repealed. The Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff say they agree that it should be repealed, and the Pentagon is currently engaged in a study of how to repeal it. Let me repeat that. They're studying how to repeal Don't Ask, Don't Tell. There's been some confusion about that, so let's be very clear about this. On March 2nd of this year, the Defense Secretary issued a memo directing this review. The review has a name. It is called the Comprehensive Review on the Implementation of a Repeal of Section 654 of Title 10 of the United States Code. In other words, they are reviewing repealing Don't Ask, Don't Tell. They're not reviewing Don't Ask, Don't Tell, the policy itself. They are reviewing the repeal of it. They are reviewing how they can mitigate any potential adverse impact of repealing the policy. They are reviewing whether repealing the policy should result in any other changes for training or standards of conduct. They're reviewing whether the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell should cause other policies and regulations to change as well. That's the review the Pentagon is engaged in right now. It's not whether to repeal the policy, it's how to repeal the policy. What's likely to be voted on tomorrow is an amendment that would make the actual legislative repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell contingent on the completion of that Pentagon review, contingent on the president and the brass considering that Pentagon review, and contingent on the president and the defense secretary and the chairman of the Joint Chiefs all signing off then that repeal is a good idea, that repeal would be consistent with the standards of military readiness, military readiness, military effectiveness, unit cohesion, and recruiting and retention of the armed forces. This is why everybody's talking about this as a compromise. It says repeal starts only as early as December, if that Pentagon review and the chairman and the secretary and the president say it can happen. Tomorrow's probably the big day for the vote on that compromise. But even if it's not done tomorrow, a group of influential military bloggers has made a splash recently because they wrote a joint statement saying that they thought that repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell is now inevitable. It said in part, quote, "Today it appears to us, today it appears inevitable to us that the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy and law restricting open homosexual behavior, respecting those displaying open homosexual behavior from serving, will be changed. And yet very little will actually change. Homosexuals have always served in the U.S. military, and there have been no real problems caused by that." Statement continues. "The U.S. military is professional and ready to adapt to the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell without compromising its mission. Echoing Secretary of Defense Gates and Admiral Mullen, we welcome open and honorable service regardless of sexual orientation." Now that would be one thing coming from a pinko hippie like me. It's another thing coming from these guys. Joining us now are two of the military bloggers who signed that letter, Jim Hansen, retired Army Special Operations Weapons Sergeant who writes for the military blog Black5.net, and J.D. Johannes, a former Marine who served on the staff of Republican Senator Sam Brownback and who was the campaign manager for Kansas Attorney General Phil Klein. J.D. is a combat correspondent and documentary filmmaker. He writes at his blog OutsideTheWire.com. Gentlemen, thank you both very much for joining us tonight.
Thanks, Rachel.
Thank you, Rachel.
Mr. Hansen, let me start with you. What was the impetus for trying to put together a statement on this issue at all? Why did you think it was important to get on the record in a collective way like this?
Well, I think I first wrote about repealing Don't Ask, Don't Tell 5 years ago. And personally, I thought it was kind of ridiculous to go ahead and say gay people can serve, but just can't act gay. Yeah, I thought that was a ridiculous thing to do. So when it came, as we said, to be more or less inevitable that it was going to happen, what we wanted was Congress and the White House to go ahead and listen to the military services as to how to implement a new policy. It's not going to be a simple thing. You know, you can go ahead and write a new rule that says it's changed, you know, go ahead and do it, and the military will salute and move out sharply. But will they then be as combat effective? And as you mentioned, will it affect unit cohesion, et cetera? So we wanted them to go ahead and listen to the services and go ahead and talk to the troops so that they felt invested in this change and like they'd been consulted. And the problem we saw was Senator Levin and some other folks seemed poised to go ahead and do what they're doing right now, which is make a political move and implement this before the military's done their study and let the troops feel, you know, that they hadn't been consulted.
But the reason
we're asking them to go ahead and let the troops have their voice.
The reason that this is a compromise, though, is that it wouldn't be implemented before the study is completed, be implemented contingent on the study being complete and the study concluding that it's a good idea. So it is. It is a compromise, and that's the thing that's changed since, I guess, since you put out the statement, actually, is that they've decided that they would vote, but it would all be contingent on the study, right?
Yeah, and I think that's a good thing. If they're willing to go ahead and wait and let the troops have their voice, let the services be consulted, and then have a plan, I think, as you mentioned, the military is ready, and as we thought, they're ready to do this. I think, honestly, I think from the troops' perspective, it's a don't ask, don't care. You know, if someone can pull their weight in a combat unit, that's a heck of a lot more important than who they're sleeping with. I mean, it, you know, gay people are everywhere. I've heard they even have their own cable TV news shows these days. You know, it's not a surprising thing. So I think the troops at the lower levels are ready. We just wanted to make sure that the policy is implemented in a way that doesn't affect us while we're in a shooting war.
Mr. Johannes, I know in addition to your time in the military and your time as a journalist, you've been active in conservative electoral politics. Do you feel like conservative opinion on this issue is diverse, that it's less uniform on this issue than it was, say, back in 93 when we first got this policy?
It is much more diverse than it was back in the early 90s. And you're exactly right when you're using the word policy. What you see within the conservative side of things is that military readiness is the priority, and being in two active wars and with a threat environment not going to be changing for years to come, we need to have a structure where we can bring in as many people who are as qualified to serve. And eliminating Don't Ask, Don't Tell opens up another pool of potential recruits, officers, and enlisted people who are already serving, and allowing them to serve honorably and effectively in combat now and into the future.
JD, I know that you have spent time with frontline troops in recent years, have seen some of your footage shot in places like Baghdad. You noted in the letter that you signed on to that there already are gay troops serving,
yes.
There always have been. If repeal passes, how do you think the lives of people who are gay, who are already in the military, how do you think their lives will change?
Honestly, from the ones that I've known in my service and in my travels covering the wars recently, I don't think there's going to be a lot of big changes. I don't think you're going to see a big flood of young men and women coming out and declaring their openness of their sexuality. I think they're going to continue to serve with distinction. And when you're deployed overseas, there's a little quirk in the rules called General Order Number 1. Sexual relations are not allowed under General Order Number 1. So you're not going to have any changes in actual behavior overseas in the combat zones in Iraq and Afghanistan. What you will find is a lot of young men and women, a lot of officers, a lot of NCOs who are serving with distinction, doing great work over there, are going to have one less burden lifted off their shoulders, one less thing to worry about. Oh no, what if I get caught when I'm home on leave? What if when we rotate back stateside I get caught? That's going to be removed, and they're going to be able to focus on the task at hand.
Jim Hansen, who I think of as Uncle Jimbo, because I am a regular reader of Black5.net, and J.D. Johannes. Thank you both for being here today. I know, I'm sure we have a million disagreements on a million military and other issues, but I think your insight on this has been both really interesting and has really stirred up some really interesting discussion on this subject. Thank you both for joining us tonight. Really appreciate it.
Great to be here, Rachel.
Thanks.
Thank you, Rachel.
Thank you.